Thank you, Satya. Power BI brings self-service analytics to the cloud and the power of the cloud directly into Excel. It opens amazing new ways for users to connect with data. So let's take a look. We have here on the screen Excel 2013. And I want to create a report about our data centers, but I don't have the data. With Power BI, we can actually go and find the data that we need. You see here online search? I'm going to use it to go and find the data for my report. I'm going to type in a search query, and just here within Excel, Power BI is searching for millions of public data tables and finding the data that I might need. It comes from Wikipedia, it comes from the marketplace, it comes from Bing. But because I'm a Microsoft employee, I'm also getting data not just from the public data sources, I'm also getting data from my enterprise data assets. Those were mapped into the catalog of Power BI. So here we see a table for my data warehouse, and I can go and add that table to my Excel, and just like that, Power BI connects and lands the data directly into my sheet, just like that. So easy. Now, I want to create my report. I'm going to go and use Power View. It's also integrated into Excel 2013. So let's go and create a nice report here. We're going to take a look at the location of the data center, the square footage of the data center. Let's make it a bit larger. It's Excel 2013, so we can just convert it immediately to a map. We can go and categorize my data centers by generation. Just with a few clicks, a beautiful report. And it's not the only report I have here in my workbook. I have a couple more. So this report here shows me the storage of Azure. Just amazing exponential growth you're seeing in the business. This one here shows me the subscriber growth in the business. You can see almost 200% in just over a year. And I can, of course, slice and dice and look at segments of users and see the growth there. So I have this beautiful report, interactive, and I want to share it with other people. And to do that, I go to the file menu, I do a save as, and I'm saving it to the Power BI site in Office 365. And now what does this site look like? Well, let's see how this site looks like in SharePoint Online. This is it. You can see how well organized it is. I see my Azure report, my Office 365 report. It's clean, it's crisp, it's beautiful. I want to go and take a look at one of those reports. I click, and of course, because the reports are all created inside Excel, the Excel web application is used to be able to browse the reports in my browser. So you can see here the exponential growth we see in the compute resources of Azure. You can go and look at other reports. These are the active database growth. And of course, the whole thing is fully interactive. So I can go select different time slices, and in the browser, get the full interaction of the data. Very easy to share, very easy to explore, but there's more than that. It's a full enterprise offering. So let's take a look at a few of the options that we have here. So see this menu here? Take a look what we have. I can share with other people. I can protect the data. I can schedule data refresh where Power BI will reach back from the cloud to the enterprise, go to the original data sources, bring the data on a regular basis, update the cloud, update the reports that we have here. I can track the data usage by my users. And one more thing I can do here, I can add that report to my mobile favorite. And you can see this small star here. Now that report is here, and it's showing up on my mobile device. It's a beautiful mobile application of Power BI. It's fully interactive that you can use it. And it's not just this report. I have a whole gallery of reports that I can use here. You can see I can browse through that. It's just the best way you can have to consume reports on the go. So you've seen what kind of a gorgeous, great offering we have here. But there's one more thing, one more capability that I think you need to see, because in my opinion, it is a true game changer. So for this, I'm going to take a look at another Power BI site. Look at this one here, and to make it a bit larger. So this one Power BI site is for a media company. And you see, as you've seen, they had before, these reports that we created in Excel. But there's another row here. We call it featured answers. And these are the most common questions my users ask about the data. For example, show our sales pipeline. I'm clicking on it, and now Power BI connects automatically to the sales side-like data source and show me the results. Now, it looks like a canned report, but it is not. It is the beginning of a conversation with Power BI. So I can continue to ask questions. Show our sales pipeline only for with opportunity size greater than 20,000. And as I type, I immediately get the answer. I can see that there are 6 opportunities greater than $20,000. Very easy, right? Now, one of those opportunities is this rock-themed event series. And I want to continue the line of interrogation. I want to ask questions about the rock song. So I can go and ask maybe the top rock classics. And notice I'm using here, something magical happened. As I was typing the question, the results came up, and actually realized I'm asking about songs, so it moved away from the pipeline data set, automatically connecting it to a different one. This one is the historical data set for all the music charts in the United States. So I can see that Bohemian Rhapsody here, by the way, my favorite song of all time, is the top rock classic. And I know it's right because Power BI tells me what it understood from me. Look at that. It tells me that when I said rock, I meant rock songs. And when I said classics, I meant a certain period of time, the 70s and the 80s. It is not the oldies from the 50s. And when I said top, it said you probably want to rank it by something, so it ranked it by the number of weeks it stayed on the chart. So I like that interpretation, but not exactly. And again, Power BI comes to help me. It said, hey, I know what you mean now, so how about instead of ranking by weeks on chart, I offer other options. Rank it by the weeks the song stayed at number one. And I can see that I Love Rock and Roll is showing as number one. And every other part of the sentence is understood with Power BI. So you say, hey, how about different time periods? Maybe you don't want to look at songs. You might want to look at artists or albums. Maybe not rock. Here's other genres. How about pop? Let's go with pop. You can see Physical, Olivia Newton-John, the top pop classics from that era. Just an easy and fun way to interrogate the data. Let's look at, for example, let's ask for songs about true love. And I can see immediately five different songs, one of them by Bing Crosby, another by Elton John, all called True Love, showing up on the charts. I can ask questions about people that I know. Songs about Bill Gates. And you'd be surprised, there's actually a song called Bill Gates showing up on the charts 3 years ago, yeah, by Lil Wayne, 1 week on the chart. I looked at the lyrics, it is actually truly not a love song. Well, we can ask more business questions, like number of songs. We can see we have 26 numbers songs in the database. Let's look at it by year. And now, notice how the system automatically detects what I'm asking, giving me a much better visualization. This is a better way to look at it. It's a chart. Automatic. I don't have to say anything. And you can see it's a very interesting chart. It shows us how many distinct songs showed up on the music chart every year. And you can see in the late 60s and early 70s, over 700 different songs on the chart. And then we go to the new millennium. You can see how it's kind of dropping gradually and getting to less than half of that when you get to the new millennium. And then there's some recovery. But when you turn on the radio and it seems like it's the same song playing again and again and again, well, now you know. We actually do listen. You have the proof. We do listen to way less songs that people in the 60s and 70s listen to. Kind of very interesting. Now, the picture is even more interesting when you look at it by genre. And again, the system just changed the visualization for me on the fly. And kind of look at that. This is the pop genre. And you see the peak that we've seen before, the decline, and some of the recovery. Rock starts the same way. Peak, decline, but it doesn't recover. Something is going on here. And look at that, hip-hop. From the mid-80s, hip-hop is growing and growing and growing, and it's not taking from rock, from pop, it's taking all the market share from rock. So you can see how the data is telling us a fascinating story of the music industry, just like that. Now, of course, you might want to know other questions. For example, what is the best song of all time? And you can see that we have here Jason Mraz with I'm Yours. And when the first time I saw that, I said, who the heck is Jason Mraz? But I had to go look at the data three times, and unfortunately, it is Jason Mraz, scientifically speaking. It's the best song of all time, over a year and a half on the charts, not like no other song. Amazing. And of course, the age-old question, who is the best artist? And now we get here, again, a different visualization, and you can see here, that amazing list of names. We have Mariah Carey, we have the Beatles, we have Usher, we have Elvis, really fantastic artists that we have here. But these are very different periods of time, and it's really hard to compare the Beatles from the 60s to Mariah Carey from now, so maybe other visualization can help me. And with Power BI, I can switch the visualization. Look at that. I have a whole list of visualization. I can change it to a table, for example. It doesn't help me to explain it. There's one more visualization here that we call the King of the Hill. And this one is specifically designed to explain changes over time. And we can see here, let me just explain how it works. It's kind of a bubble chart. In the middle, we have the biggest bubble. It will be the artist that has the most weeks at number one on the chart. It is the king, right? It's going to be the center, big bubble. Around him will be the contenders, the people who want to take the center's position from him, the other artists with less weeks on the chart. And we're going to animate over the time dimension. So we start with 1955, the backwater of Frank Sinatra, Pat Boone. And we're going to see the Motown area. So we're going to see here the Platters joining in. But in 1957, something amazing happening. Elvis Presley breakthrough with All Shook Up, and he is the king. This is Elvis in the seventh world. He's going to have over 100 different songs on the Billboard 100. It's just dominating. But the 60s come to the middle, and from over the pond, the greatest band in the history of music, the Beatles, are showing up, and they're going to have 26 number one hits. They're going to have 8 consecutive ones. They're just dominating the rest of the decade into the 70s, but they're breaking up. And this is a kind of a weird transition, people. Look at that. Three Dogs Night. Never heard about them? Forget about them, because the next one is going to be Elton John. He's a legend. Candle in the Wind is still the number one selling single of all time. This is also the disco era. So who do you have here? The Bee Gees. I danced to their songs with my first girlfriend. And of course, they start as young singer in their song, in their movie. It was Olivia Newton-John, a giant megastar in the early 80s. And now look at that. What do you have in the 80s? Paul McCartney, going to be followed up by Michael Jackson, going to be followed by Madonna. Look at the list of names, going to be followed up by Whitney Houston. This is the parade of the great we have in the 80s. Look at George Michael comes from over the phone. What a period. Paula Abdul, I have no idea what she's doing here. Now, we're seeing Mariah here. She is going to dominate the 90s. She's going to have a fight with Boyz II Men. But look at her. She's faking to the other side and she's pushing them out. She is going to continue with 79 weeks at number one. She's going to dominate the 90s, but the 90s are coming to an end. Santana with Smooth is taking over. He is going to take over that. And then it's of course the hip hop and rap. It's Nelly with songs My Kids Love, I Cannot Stand. And then Usher, he's a genius. Wonderful, wonderful song fight. But look, who's back. It's Mariah. She's over here again. She's looking for an opening. She's a fighter. And she's pushing it out, but the 80s showing up. Back 80s are taking over, and now we are getting ready to the era of the divas. Rihanna, look at her, she's taking over. Katy Perry trying, Adele is trying, but no, Rihanna is here to stay. Thank you, Rihanna. Thank you, Power BI. Thank you all.